The pelican has evoked a certain awe since the dawn of man. This primordial scene of life and death and parental care is in an isolated breeding rookery with a doubtful future. Man's world now crowds the pelican. It's a tragic comic bird whose golden age has now passed. An Aboriginal Dreamtime story tells us that all pelicans were black in the past. It was Bora who changed this. Bora had an argument with some Aborigines, and in his fury, he splashed white paint over his body. The younger birds were tired of their dull plumage. They revolted and also painted themselves white. Pelicans are a familiar sight in our urban waterways. They do mix with people, and this is their downfall. We contaminate our waterways and the fish the pelicans eat. When they later lay eggs, they may be thin-shelled and break before hatching. Tourists and pelicans attract each other. They hang around for our handouts. Feeding his friend undersized fish got one old man into trouble.
He's a good boy.
Every day he just flies down out of the sky and comes down and settles down beside me in this terrific company. I'm in trouble because of you. You know that? They're going to fine me $500 because I've been feeding you whiting. But I'm not feeding you whiting today. I'm feeding you the pilchards from the bait shop. There you are. That's a good boy. I feel bad if I let him down. I don't give him the fish that I'm used to giving him. He doesn't understand if I catch fish and I throw them back and don't share some of them with him.
Today in Harvey Bay Courthouse, he was fined $350.
And I'm being stopped from having a loving relationship with a wild bird. I can't believe this is supposed to be Australia, not Russia. He's come down to see me every day out of the sky for 15 months. I didn't make this relationship, he did.
The poor man suffered a heart attack the next day. In these crowded estuaries where both fishers and pelicans compete for the catch, it's inevitable pelicans will be hooked too. To the rescue come Wendy Gillespie and Shane Sutton of Waterbird Rescue Queensland, a Sunshine Coast group dedicated to saving pelicans snared by hooks and fishing lines. K71 is wounded and requires medical attention. Darcy and Di Eve lure it in so they can grab it.
K71 is the juvenile male that we bring in. He's about a year old. This will be the third time he's been entangled in a fortnight. We took this off him on Saturday in the corner of his wing that was around his legs as well.
And you can see he's got a hook in the rib cage. And it's gone through to the wing. The pelican has a couple of sharp rose edges down the inside of the beak, inside, and they can inflict a decent gash on people that try to feed pelicans. That's why you shouldn't go near them.
Yeah, this bit should just go straight through.
Oh, okay.
Yep, that one through the skin. to give it a bit of a pull. That should back out for now. Yep.
Okay. Oh, here we go. Still got the bait ball. It's an old nest. Sorry. With some Ceylon or hexadine through the hole.
I can come back now during the week or next week. I can look at the bird, look at the record, 71. I can look at his wing when he lifts it up to get a bit of fish. If it looks like it's not healing good enough, we can put anti-bites in a fish. We don't have to catch him again. And there's less stress for the bird.
In the last 12 months, we've actually rescued over 500 pelicans, and a lot of cases, these are juveniles coming straight from the nest and finding that they can get a free feed at a fish cleaning table or a commercial feeding venture. They get into an injury cycle that we have to repeatedly capture these birds.
We recommend that you don't feed the pelicans, because our experience is the habituation that goes with feeding them, the poor nutrition that comes from people, particularly in canals, feeding dog sausage, chicken carcasses, and the poor health of the pelicans. The next phase is they fly into unattended set lines, they end up in injury cycle.
This is something else that we do as well. We collect all of the discard tackle because it's particularly a bad danger to pelicans and other wader birds also.
This pelican was caught at Caloundra. It had a lure in the top of its bill and on the inside of its bottom bill. It had to be caught and taken out, but it survived. It would have starved to death otherwise. Caught on Mother's Day morning, a pelican at Bly Bly. The fishing line had severed its leg, and it had to be euthanized after we caught it and took it to the vet. It was an adult female ready for breeding. This pelican was caught in the Maroochy River. It had a set of gang hooks in it, one in the wing, two in the rib cage, and one in its back. It was handicapped severely, but it survived after we caught it and removed the hooks. This pelican had a hook in its knee joint, which caused it to inflame, infection set in. It survived with antibiotics and anti-inflammatories. It's out there now, still going okay. This pelican was had discarded fishing line around one of its legs. It could have severed the leg. It was very close to it, but we did get it in time, and it survived. It has a limp, but it's still getting around okay.
This pelican we've brought in many times, but we weren't lucky on this occasion. All the other times we've treated him, he had tackle injuries, which took quite a lot of rehabilitation and care. It's a bit of a sad issue for us.
Identical twins Paul and Bridget Powers join the rescue group. They're looking out for injured birds.
This is the adult male peli that was brought in at Maroochydore on the weekend, and he had a set of gang hooks embedded through his bill.
And on his wing?
Yep. It was actually sticking out and was cutting, chopping up all his wing as he was preening. The impacts on waterways from a greater population and greater recreational use are going to impact on the fish and any species living in the waterways, with the contaminants accumulating, and logically the top predator, the pelican, is going to suffer with those impacts. This year we're now getting a lot of very sick pelicans with bacterial infections of the gut, and we're getting a range of blood tests undertaken to see what we're dealing with.
It's unbelievable that thousands of pelicans are hooked and wounded by fishers. Thank goodness many are now saved by this volunteer rescue group.
He's still heading out that way. We won't take our eyes off him.
Okay.
And he's got all fishing line wrapped around his feather.
And it's a female adult.
Come on, girls, now.
Okay.
There you go, easy. Okay.
Yep.
We're going to have a look underneath this wing.
Yep. Come, sweetheart.
There's the hook's not the real problem in this case.
It's the line that's around the wing, it's in the corner of the wing. If it's not removed, it just cuts through the tendon of the wing, they lose their wing. Usually this is caused when there's a sinker on the end of the line, that it goes around the wing as they flap, sawed backwards and forwards, and then tightened up and just cut right through that.
That's a good sign, isn't it, when you see a loose feather or something like that, and then you can tell that they're in trouble.
I'll just cut that line.
Yep. You'll feel better, sweetheart, then.
Oh,
gorgeous boy.
Pulls out.
Yep.
It's a good feeling you can get this out of a pelican early like this, and he's only going to lose a feather by the looks of it, and a bit of his dignity, but he would have lost the wing with this, a definite.
Regurgitate. Come on, sweetheart. Good boy. You'll have to go out for another catch now. Yep. Good boy. He's happy he's not all tangled up anymore.
While coastal pelicans suffer from hooks and pollution, inland lakes offer clean water and food. Skipper Annette Bourne of Lake Barine Rainforest Cruises offers tourists an opportunity to see pelicans close up in an unspoiled environment. Waterfront homes line man-made Lake Kinneroo, west of Cairns. Flooded trees are perches for the thousands of little black cormorants who have made the new lake their home, along with 100 or so resident pelicans. Pelicans and cormorants cooperate in their daily feeding. The pelicans drive the fish into the shallows where both birds easily catch them. When the cormorants fly off to locate new feeding grounds, the pelicans follow. Group feeding is synchronized. Bullying tactics are used to snatch a fish from the cormorant. Wringing a cormorant's neck is a sure way to steal the catch. Water-soaked wings need drying so the bird can fly. It's quite a put-off having your neck wrung, so the cormorant agrees to a unique arrangement with the pelican. There's a lot of fish out in the deep water, and the pelican can't reach them. The cormorant can. It's a great diver and can hold its breath for 40 seconds. So to avoid being bullied, single cormorants fish the deep water for the pelican, passing over its entire catch. Lake Kinneroo has scenic pockets. Life throbs above and below the water. dusk and dawn, one can see Australia's weirdest creature out on the lake, created according to Aboriginal legend by the mating of a duck and a water rat. It's the platypus. Its eyes are closed when it dives because it finds its food by electrolocation. Barramundi grow huge in Lake Tinaroo. The world record was caught here, a massive 38 kilos. It's the month of March, the last of the monsoonal wet season. This heralds the awakening of a primeval urge in the pelicans to migrate to their breeding rookery. Their feeding partners, the little black cormorants, take wing at the same time to their own rookery. They come from all parts of Queensland. For some, it's a journey of 2,000 kilometres. Ocean and land fall away as they circle upwards to reach the thermal currents. Most magnificent flyers, they peel off at the top of the thermal and descend on a long glide to their destination. Pelican Island is a windswept sandspit at the mouth of the Smithbourne River in the Gulf of Carpentaria. It will become a makeshift home for 2,000 pelicans over the next 3 months. Wooing a mate and commencing a family proceeds in the silence of a primitive charade. The adult pelican neither sings nor calls. Their language of gestures and movement is highly developed. The simple act of one female receiving grass from a selected male for her nest is the bonding of a 3-month marriage on Pelican Island. Some arrive a little too late. There just isn't a spare female to take his offering. Two or three chalky white eggs are laid. The nests are simple, a hollow in the sand, casually lined with twigs and grass. In this ultra-hot climate, the pelican does not have to sit all day on the eggs to incubate them. They wander off to the water's edge and feed on the bountiful fish. Diane Costa uses their absence to count the nests. There are two nesting sites, one on the vegetation and the other out on the windswept sandspit.
How many?
Well, I was able to count 932. That sounds like a lot.
No, that's not good. When I was here last time and counted them, there were 4,000 nests. But 10 years before that, 10,000 nests. 930, no, that's 10% of what was here before. And that means they're on a rapid decline.
The snake is on a mission. It knows there are choice pelican eggs up ahead. Incubation takes 30 days, so to pass the time till the chicks hatch, we explore the wilderness area. I find the cormorants have chosen their nesting site just 10 kilometres north of Pelican Island in the centre of a dense mangrove swamp. I follow a stately jabiru along the river bank to where it greets its mate on the nest. The chick is only a few weeks old. The other two eggs have failed to hatch. The parents share a 2-hour spell on the nest. It's the female's turn now to catch some fish, while the male tends the baby with loving care. The baby has a big appetite. It consumes almost its equivalent in body weight each day. Since ancient times, the jabiru has enjoyed a kind of veneration which has served to protect it and is sacred to many Aboriginal tribes. The Smithbourne River is alive with fish. That's why the pelicans choose to nest here. John Gammy, Kerry Eckersley and Diane Costa catch live bait for some fishing.
You've got a Popeye, that one.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
John. A little puffer fish. Throwing back.
Hmm. It's a valley or something.
What do you got there?
I'm not sure. It looks like a little queen fish.
Oh, look at the ray. It's getting food from the bank.
Salmon, is it?
Oh, okay. He's a nice salmon too.
Ah, good work.
Love it. Great fun, eh? Where else could you want to be? Get him another day.
Look at them all. Look at them. Christ. Baby salmon. If we don't get them down to the water soon, they'll all die. Come on.
Yeah, we do. Look at the golden tail on him.
Yeah, we get to see the boat.
Got to hold him by the mouth, Di.
Okay.
He won't bite you. But see his gills? You just got to watch his gills. Just put your finger in his mouth like I have.
Yeah.
And hold on tight.
Yeah. And just under here. Here he goes. Out in the sun. Okay.
The haphazard business of life and death runs its course. By merciless decree, the embryos continue to develop. The blistering wind blows nests apart and covers eggs with drifting sand. The struggle to emerge in the torrid sun gives the chick the strength to survive. They are strange naked objects with wrinkly bodies and wobbly heads, a reminder of the reptilian ancestry of birds. The heat takes its toll. Dozens of chicks die in the first few days of their life. Hermit crabs feed on the dead. Thin-shelled eggs, the result of eating polluted fish, are easily crushed by the stomping feet of courting birds. An eagle is the winner here. Above work the hawks. Eagle eyes pick out only the dead. Nature's winged scavengers assume the role of garbage collectors. There's no need to take those alive. The high mortality rate waxes fat the hawks and eagles of Pelican Island. An empty stretch of sand has a sorry tale to tell.
This is Walker's Island on the mouth of the Nassau River, about 100 nautical miles north of Pelican Island. Now, go back 40 years ago, this was the largest pelican rookery in the world. There were 50,000 nests, and that means 100,000 adults, and double that when you start to count the chicks. But 10 years later, the entire rookery disappeared. And at first we thought, well, maybe they've gone elsewhere. But no, there was no other great rookery like this appeared somewhere else. They just simply disappeared. And that has been a big worry.
Pelican Island is inundated with thousands of jellyfish. Their adult life is short. Bivalves and hermit crabs slowly devour the jelly blobs. Pop-eyed mullet are the staple diet of the pelicans. There are millions of them in the shallows. In this rich fishing ground of the remote Gulf, an abundance of one creature is a dependable harvest and life support for so many others. Travellers all the way from Siberia, the massive sharp-tailed sandpipers join the migratory call to Pelican Island. They feed around the clock to add 50% to their body weight. This fat is fuel for their 15,000-kilometre return journey. The Jabiru chick is now half grown. The most moving thing I am witnessing is the devotion and continual care both parents lavish on their young. The pelican chicks are also half grown, flat-footed comics with a waddling gait. They group in creches, finding sanctuary with each other. No bird rookery is complete without the scavenging seagulls, and more reason so if the company are good fishers. The pelican world is a language of silent gestures. The male even bows to the female before he copulates with her. The incredible backward yawn exercises and airs the distendable pouch that holds the fish. The hungry chick must reach right down into the parent's gullet to retrieve the fish. The insatiable appetites of the young must be matched by the food collecting efforts of the parents. A pelican eats half a kilo of fish per day, and that means 1,500 kilos is caught each day to support this rookery. A daily dip for the chicks presents a danger from the sharks. A sheltered mangrove lagoon teems with a pop-eyed mullet. A pelican's pouch can hold 15 litres of water. Now that's twice its own body weight. By tilting the slightly open bill, the water drains out and traps the fish. Crocodiles are another threat. Each chick leaves the creche and finds its parent with begging calls for its feed. Demands more and gets it. One way to silence demanding chicks is to fill them right up. Greed is not tolerated in the communal rookery. But gluttony is a natural instinct in a growing chick. They must feather their own nest in order to survive. 30 years ago, I came here with Eva and filmed the same rookery. There were a lot more birds. Back then, we built a shelter to escape the heat and discreetly record the behaviour of this comical bird. Pelican expert Roman Pawlowski counted the nests, 4,000 in all. That's four times the birds we are seeing today. When the explorer Matthew Flinders discovered a great pelican metropolis, he remarked, "None are more likely to be free from disturbance of every kind when choosing this hidden lagoon on an uninhabited island off an unknown coast." That rookery has been abandoned. Civilization crowded those pelicans on Kangaroo Island. Even though the pop-eyed mullet were abundant, there just weren't enough fish to feed this big rookery of 8,000 adults and 5,000 chicks. We tried to help by catching a big saw shark. The chicks were not conditioned to take such handouts, so we had to force feed them. Pelicans have a pair of salt glands recessed into their frontal bones, so there's no need for fresh water. They just need food. Godparent for so many starving chicks, Eva's effort proved to be merely a gesture way back 30 years ago. While waiting for the chicks to become fledged, we go fishing again.
Place him in the net.
Yes.
Hey. Queenie.
Whoa. Thank you, lady dog.
You're welcome.
Also fishing behind Pelican Island is a barra boat with the escapist name of Selfish Man. Owner Greg Music hauls in his set nets that snare the prized barramundi.
Now, this brain spiking is instant death. Fish dies instantly and he doesn't release any of his toxins into his flesh, so he lasts up to 4 weeks on ice.
The rich harvest of bait fish the pelicans eat is also nursery food for baby sharks. This newborn hammerhead will be released. Greg checks his nets regularly so that the barra are freshly caught before being put on ice. It's a profitable family business from a bountiful river. Hard work, but a rewarding lifestyle. Tracy is a mud crab catcher. That's why she's so deft at tying them up.
Now, you wiggle them like this, and their nippers should settle, but it's not going to. Thank you.
Seeing Tracy's crab haul sends us on a mission to catch our own succulent dinner.
Okay, do you want to have a go at grabbing him?
No, we might just tip him straight
in. Why not?
Straight in for dinner tonight.
Oh, he just... There you go, little buddy. Beautiful work. Oh, that is done well.
I think it's bigger than the last one, you know.
Do you think so? Catch some more dinner for tomorrow. Straight down.
Any spare fish we toss to the pelicans. The fledged chick is now as big as its parent. The chicks practice scooping up the pop-eyed mullet, but still rely on the parent for most of their food. I hope he makes it. A parent wisely refuses to feed its big chick in the water because it could choke and drown. It's dinner time. They can't fly yet, so it's a hop and flap to the table in adolescent awkwardness. They're still big kids. The chick has to plunge its beak right down the parent's throat. It's a suffocating way to have a meal, a choking ordeal for both. Starved of oxygen, the chick collapses. This performance is never fatal. Fully fledged means ready to fly. It does take a lot of practice. Finally, he lifts his undercarriage off the ground. Within a week, they will master flying techniques and can depart the rookery. Already, they are copying adult gestures. The crocodile is stalking a strange fish that escapes by walking on land. As the tide drops and exposes the mud bank, hundreds of mud skippers appear. They're territorial, and the raised dorsal fin is warning, keep away from my little mud hole. Mm-hmm. An opportunist feeder, a sea snake slithers down a mudskipper's hole. It's been 3 months since the pelicans arrived. Now it's time to leave. The rich waters of Pelican Island have provided sanctuary and food for these difficult months. The pop-eyed mullet will relish the pelican's departure. There is one who remains behind. Too old for the long journey, it stays and dies alone. We have witnessed the primeval urge evolved over eons, from times too slow to turn back this magnificent bird. They rise high on the thermal currents. Pelican Island is laid bare below. They sweep across the land on a great dispersal flight to the East Coast feeding grounds. Lake Tinaroo welcomes the return of its pelicans. They have timed their arrival for a similar return of the cormorants from their own nesting site. The pelicans do need their little diving mates. The rapid decline in numbers does not stem from the natural problems we witnessed at Pelican Island. It's their choice of habitat when they return. Here the fledged progeny will survive well on this lake's clean fish. Another skill the grown chicks quickly learn is how to rob and train a cormorant. For those who choose to return to our crowded estuaries, their future will be different. This year, another 500 pelicans will be hooked and snared on the Sunshine Coast. Perhaps another 2,000 more will be injured across Australia. This is the plight of the pelican on our own doorstep, and only those spotted by the volunteer rescue teams will be saved. The Noosa dump draws the naive juveniles to an unhealthy diet.
What we're seeing now with these juveniles, they've just come from the rookery. Instead of going to the estuary, they're feeding here on the dump.
Yeah, it's a major source of their nutrition, and we've had the first juvenile die just behind the dump, about a 6-month-old pelican.
I returned to Pelican Island the next nesting season. It's been a poor wet, so little rain, and I notice the pop-eyed mullet are not prolific like the year before. I wonder how the pelicans are faring with so little food. Only a few pelicans sit on a nearby sand spit. None are attending their eggs. They seem to have walked away. I sense a grave problem when I see the wind-blown sand burying the eggs.
This is a disaster. Now, these eggs have been laying here for more than a month, and they're hatching. But the pelicans are still over there in the sandbank. They haven't come back to the rookery when they're supposed to. And those chicks have died quite quickly because no food or shelter. And the hawks and the eagles have come down and stripped the rookery clean. Not a chick in sight. Not one chick has survived. And yet last year, we had a healthy rookery. Maybe down a bit, but still healthy. And about 1,500 chicks flew home back to the East Coast. And I don't know why this has happened. It's really a repeat of what happened at Walker's Island at the mouth of the Nassau 40 years ago. And if you think about 40 years ago, there were two rookeries, 60,000 nests. Now, last year we had less than 1,000. And that is a dramatic drop of 98%. And so this barren waste of sand is a graphic example of the plight of the pelican.